Asia's richest man, Jack Ma, has donated more than 50,000 testing kits to the Philippines. Let's get more details on that from San Lazaro Hospital's Adult Infectious Diseases and Tropical Medicine Chief, Dr. Ron Jean Solante. Good morning, Doctor, and thank you very much for joining us again.
Good morning, Christian.
Okay, how many testing kits did the San Lazaro Hospital receive exactly from Jack Ma, which I understand were coursed through Senator Manny Pacquiao?
Okay, the total number of kits that we received last Friday is like 57,600. And we have this into two. Half of that went to the UPPGH, and half of that is with us here in San Lazaro Hospital.
Okay, are these kits, are these test kits now being used by San Lazaro Hospital?
Okay, so we have to go to, again, a process before we can actually use these kits to our clients or patients. One, we have to write a letter to the Food and Drug Administration that we have these kits. We have to specify what are the specs of these kits, and then the sensitivity, specificity, all of the technical information that is needed by the FDA. And then after that, once approved, then we will start the validation. We'll be sending some of the kits to RITM for validation. And once the validation process will be done, then that's the only time we can really use these kits to our patients. So meaning it's not that easy to just use the kit. And when you receive this kit, it has to go through a process of validation and approval before you can use this. So it will take around like probably or hopefully 1 week. We can shorten the process by submitting those necessary requirements so that we can use these test kits to our patients.
So that is the time frame for all these procedures to be completed, at least 1 week. Now, what is the promised accuracy of these testing kits?
These are PCR test kits. So again, this is the gold standard in the diagnosis of the virus. And this is what we are recommending to all testing centers as much as possible, since we are in the phase of doing active surveillance and diagnosing patients with the infection.
Okay, so just to be clear, because there was a report that another set of donated testing kits from China only had 40% accuracy. So in terms of type, the testing kits that you received from Jack Ma, are they similar or not with those that have been reported to have only 40% accuracy? They're different or what?
It's not similar. I think the test kits you are you're pertaining to or referring to are the antibody test kits. So that is not what we want to get now for hospital-based diagnostic tests, because the current accepted diagnostic confirmatory test is with the use of your polymerase chain reaction.
Okay, let's talk about the difference here, because some people might get too excited when it comes to reports that certain countries, certain governments, certain areas have been getting huge number of huge volumes of donations of testing kits. But let's talk about the differences. For example, what's the difference between an antibody test and a RT-PCR type test that you're talking about now?
Okay, so we'll start with the RT-PCR. The RT-PCR is a method by which you detect a component of the microorganism, so which means it directly detects the specific microorganism, if it's a virus, a bacteria, or other microorganisms. So meaning, once you get the result, then that is already confirmatory.
That means you have the virus.
Yes, if you have the virus. The antibody test is, it depends on how much your antibody is produced in your body. Okay, so it will only be positive once you have that threshold of an antibody that is detected in that kit. And that's why when you look at sensitivity 40 to 60%, because it is also dependent on at what point of the clinical course you did the test. Second, are what particular group of patients did you do the test? If there are patients who are immunocompromised, and most likely they cannot also produce adequate level of antibody, then that's the danger there, because you might have a false negative result among these patients. So you have to look into the context of when are you going to use this, how will it be useful, and how will you be able to interpret if this is the result of the test.
Because different patients have different periods when it comes to when they actually produce antibodies in response to the COVID-19, right?
Yes, precisely correct.
Okay, so I understand the antibody test type involves blood extraction. Is that correct?
Yes, and I would like to add that it uses blood, and if you are positive with that, you base it also, you correlate clinically, but it doesn't end there. You still have to diagnose and you have to confirm it if there is really an active infection, because an antibody level can be positive even during the convalescent stage or during the active stage of the infection. So you still have to confirm it with the RT-PCR test kit.
So you cannot just rely on an antibody blood test to determine whether or not you had the virus or not. You need to confirm it still with an RT-PCR. Now, how about the rapid testing kits? What are they? How do they work?
Actually, when you say rapid testing kits, it's the method by which you get the result within 2 or 3 hours. It can be both. You have also a rapid PCR test, okay, and you can get the result within 45 minutes to as long as one hour. You can also have the rapid antibody test, in which you can get also the result within like 5 minutes or 10 minutes based on the method by which it is being done. Okay? So both of these tests can have a rapid way of, in terms of the procedure, the turnaround time of the procedure.
Now, this donated testing kits from JACMA, are they rapid testing kits or just a regular type?
No, this is the regular type. You need to have what you call this, a biosafety level type of molecular diagnostic laboratory. And when you are required to do that, because the complexity of that test, also you need to do it in an environment where you will not be contaminated. Okay, you have to follow the biosafety level laboratory requirement for you to set up this particular and to do this particular test.
Okay,
which is the important part there, is to really put the safety of the one running the test and not just an ordinary room or any ordinary laboratory.
Okay, and we know that San Lazaro Hospital has been designated as one of the subnational laboratories to process samples taken by the testing kits from prospective or suspected COVID-19 patients. Now, since you got half of the 57,600 testing kits donated by JACMA, how will this now affect or help improve the testing capacity and the speed by which results might be made available, at least in San Lazaro?
Okay, now in that context, we also need to review also and look at our manpower, okay? Because even if you have those thousands of kits and you only have 2 or 3 doing the testing in your hospital or laboratory, and like 8 hours, 12 hours processing of the test by batch, like 22 tests, and then you only have 1, 2, or 3 manpower, and then that will not be enough because you'll only be releasing like 40 to 60 or processed 40 to 60 specimens in a day. So you have to look into it. Will you be adding manpower to do the test? And that will be an important factor for you to really, again, do a lot of these tests in one day by also increase the capacity of your manpower to do the test.
So in case of San Lazaro Hospital, since you have you received half of 57,600 testing kits, does it mean that the process will be quicker now or not necessarily?
Okay, now our manpower is also limited, okay? Like we only have 2 or 3 who will process the test, okay? And the only advantage is that instead of sending it to our ATM, then we can process here, and we can also unload the number of specimens that our ATM is getting, okay? We still have to our priority as of this moment are those that are in San Lazaro Hospital, that are admitted in San Lazaro Hospital or being referred to San Lazaro Hospital. We haven't had yet that directive to accept refer or accept specimens from other hospitals, and that's we're going to discuss probably tomorrow with the management on how to go about this, because what's the priority now is our own patients, and our capability is also limited because we only have a few of these medical technologists who can run the test.
Okay, in case of San Lazaro Hospital, what is the volume of tests that is conducted, that are conducted every day? For example, how many results do you come up with?
Yeah, we started with 20, and then we had 40, and I hope by every week we can increase that by 20, so that hopefully we can get like 80 to 100 tests a day. That would be very helpful already.
And how many confirmed cases do you have now?
Oh, okay. So we opened our ward. Okay, we have this particular ward and converted it into individual rooms. Okay, because our 24 capacity beds, isolation rooms, are already full, and we have to open another ward to accommodate walk-in patients or referrals. And these are additional 10 isolation rooms. So we may be able to accommodate 36 of this, total of 36 or, yeah, 36 number of patients. And we're now 24, I think we now have like 27, 28 admitted patients.
Okay, so 27 to 28 confirmed cases. When are you expecting to, let's say, reach full capacity? Because you mentioned that with expanded wing or beds that you mentioned, you can only accommodate up to 36. So given that number that you mentioned, 27 to 28, you only have a few beds left. What happens afterward?
In fact, just yesterday, we already had new eight admissions. Okay, and it's just a matter of probably today we'll be in full capacity already.
And can you turn away patients? Of course not.
Definitely not.
So what will you do?
Yes, if our capacity is really, if the wards are already full, then that's the time that we cannot really accept patients, because one is that our PPE is only allocated for these number of isolation rooms that we have now. And then we also have to factor in our healthcare workers who will be going on duty taking care of these wards with COVID positive patients. So we cannot compromise safety of our healthcare workers at the same time while taking care of these patients. They are also important, but the healthcare workers are also equally important, that we have to protect them and to prevent acquiring the infection while on at work.
So far, how many doctors, nurses, and other medical workers are under monitoring or have tested positive for COVID-19 at San Lazaro Hospital?
Okay, so since we did have the capacity to detect the test, no? So this is what I did, and with the approval of the administration, the medical director, and our chief of clinics in the hospital, we screened all, or we tested all our healthcare workers who were assigned to these wards. And then, although some of them have symptoms, okay, only I think one or two have symptoms, but we tested all of these. And we found out that three of our healthcare workers were COVID positive. So that's why we are also putting them in these isolation rooms. And I plan to recommend also to my medical director that I'll do testing for this COVID, for these healthcare workers, hopefully in a regular manner, like every 2 weeks, just to make sure that even if they are asymptomatic, they have to be tested for them to know their status of COVID.
Okay, so you have three positive cases so far, and how many are under quarantine?
So far, we don't have anybody under quarantine, because in our policy, once they are negative and they don't have the symptoms, then they can go back to work.
How about those who came in contact with the three positive cases?
Yeah, we did contact tracing of all the healthcare workers, including those in the non-COVID areas. And all of them are asymptomatic, and all of them were tested, and we see to it that they are negative before they can go back to their post or duty.
So they're now back to work?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this is an interesting thing that you mentioned. Your recommendation is to actually test the medical workers, the doctors, nurses, and other health workers of San Lazaro to be tested every 2 weeks, right? Is this something that should also be done in other hospitals? In as many hospitals that can do this, to make sure that those frontliners are properly taken care of, and to make sure that they can keep on going in terms of caring for the patients, because they themselves are being taken care of.
Correct. No? One is, when you are dealing with this infection, okay, when you regularly talk with these healthcare workers, okay, there's always this fear and uncertainty that they may be having the infection, they may be having the virus, but they are yet asymptomatic. The fear that they cannot go back to their home and see their families, and at the same time, the fear that what if I am infected, I will develop the symptoms, and I did not know my status, and I'm already infecting or exposing them for me. So those are the important parameters that why I did this recommendation, to alleviate that fear. And with that, the alleviation, somehow they are also encouraged to work and be part of the management of these patients.
Okay, now let's talk about the pace of testing nationwide. The Department of Health is getting a lot of criticism because there are now at least 1,075 total confirmed cases in the country, and of course the number of fatalities, 68 deaths, and then just last Saturday, 272 new cases. But if you talk about the actual testing done, of course there's a big debate regarding that, on whether you should count the number of individuals actually tested or the number of actual tests conducted on different individuals. How do we speed this thing up? Because there's a lot of concern that we're not actually getting a full or real picture of the infection here in the Philippines because we're not testing enough people.
Well, in a manner, I agree with some of those thoughts that we are not testing all of them. And I think that's normal because our testing capabilities is really limited. And at the same time, we have an algorithm that we will only test and prioritize those who have mild symptoms and with comorbidities, or those patients that are admitted in the hospital. So who are left that were not tested? So these are the mildly symptomatic that were sent home for strict quarantine procedures. And I think I have emphasized this one in previous conversation, that it is now the work, the level of load will now be in the community, okay? If you are proactive with and serious with the community quarantine, it's not just locking down the community. You have to go house to house. You have to survey every house who are symptomatic, the mildest symptom. Then you have to give instruction. Are they being strictly quarantined? Are they in a separate room? Are they wearing face masks? If you cannot do these things and they're still within that confine of the room together with the other members of the family, then you continue to transmit the virus, okay? And then when they go out, like they go to the market to buy something or to buy the necessity, then that can be an area also that some of them that can be mildly symptomatic, if they don't know they are already symptomatic, can transmit the infection still in the community.
Okay, now this lockdown started March 17. And we're now 12 days into that enhanced community quarantine for the entire Philippine island of Luzon. How soon, in terms of epidemiology, how soon can we expect or can we see or notice certain changes, or can we gauge whether this particular measure is working?
Okay, I would like to share with you some of the cases that we have now here in San Lazaro. If you look at the cases that we have now, the symptoms, most of them started symptoms like March 12, March 13, and March 14, okay? And then it progress, and then eventually they're admitted. So it's not yet out of that the lockdown was March 16 or 17, but the symptoms, they had the symptoms March 14, 15. So you have to count the number of people that they had infected during that time that the lockdown was not yet implemented. And that tells you a lot, that why we are still getting a lot of these patients in the hospital, okay? And this is also the reason why that if we look at the successful lockdown, if this lockdown is very successful, then we'll be looking at, again, 2 weeks, because the incubation period by which a particular individual will manifest is within that 14 weeks. So we are now on how many days? 9 days?
12 days.
12 days, okay? So probably we can add another week and look at the trend. And after that week, we will evaluate and see if the trend of the infection is going down. But up to now, we have observed it's still going up.
Yeah, the curve is still upward. So basically, we're talking here still of cases that or infections which took place before the actual lockdown, right?
Yes, correct.
So next week would be crucial, and the week after that.
Yes.
Okay, on that note, thank you very much, Dr. Ronjin Solante, for joining us this morning. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, Christian.